there's too many of you to cry. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you die. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah.
So the topic here is minding our mental health under crisis and gratifying grief. This is an important topic. It's important. It's near and dear to me. One, because of having to deal with my own personal experiences around grief, as well as helping others through grief. And you know, this COVID-19 thing brings a whole. There's a whole new element to the grief process. So I'm going to talk a little bit about grief, a little bit about stress, and why I think it's important to have that conversation. And then what are some strategies that we can use while isolating, right? And then to look at some health-related stress support, as well as a little bit about parenting, because some of us have teenagers. And it's been a real trip for them, too. Just some of the things that we need to pay attention to, including social media.
Sure.
So I want to unapologetically state that we feel that it's important that we understand that our people's experience in this country was one of enslavement. And that's why we don't say slaves, we say enslaved Africans.
Yes.
Because we are... Indeed, African. To be stolen from one's mother does not make you any less her child or any less a member of the family. And we were in fact stolen.
Yes.
So I want to make the point that our healing then really is going to come from the extent to which we can reach back and process being African. The great Asa Hilliard, Dr. Hilliard, stated that to be African or not to be is the question. To be African or not to be. Hmm. And in that, we recognize the system's attempts to kill, to destroy everything that is African. I'm going to set my timer here because I want to make sure we have the Q&A. And I want to say that at this time, you know, we've had folks pass away. I've had four people transition that were in my family or that I know closely, and not being able to make the funeral, not being able to, you know, send them off, right? Has anyone else had that experience? Well, it's sad. It's devastating experience, and so in many ways, the normal grief process has been interrupted. Right? If we think about the grief process as looking at going through the initial, intermediate, and final phases of grief, we know that. A very important piece is that intermediate piece, and it starts really typically right after the formal organizational tribute to the person we've lost. Mm-hmm. We haven't been able to have that. The extent to which we can look at our African beliefs, we will be able to, I highly believe we'll be able to create peace with the situation as it is. The isolation then represents an opportunity to come back home. Mm-hmm. To come back home to Mother Africa.
To come Tony, back I'm home. Sorry to interrupt you,
yes.
But 499-9349 needs to mute because I'm having trouble hearing you because I'm hearing all their background noise.
Oh, I got you. Thank you. Good looking out. I mean, let me check participants too to make sure that nobody's, I don't see anyone else in the waiting room now. Okay. So the idea is to return home to Mother Africa and return to our own homes. That may mean paying attention, that may mean spending more time than we used to with our family and getting to know each other a little better in a closer way. Baba Wade Nobles is always very clear on the fact that we are spirit beings having a human experience at this place and time. And so it really is a matter of spiritness, right? Spiritness, as well as spirituality. In other words, you know, we come here spirits and we're manifesting. We have a day of manifesting, and we call that birthday, right?
Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
I've seen 12 little green phone calls popping up. Is that 12 people trying to chime in on us?
Let me check. Let me close that thing and come here. Now, I only see 9 participants, and I don't see anyone. Let's see. I don't see anyone in the waiting room.
Okay.
At this point. Let me look again here. Boom. Okay. Yeah. So that looks the same. And so, in doing so,
Tony, I'm sorry, but the person still, I don't even know if they hear, they're still, you can still hear all their noise. And I don't know if they know it's area code 510-499-9349. Can you mute please? Because we can hear all of your stuff as Dr. Jackson's talking.
Thank you, Dr. Patricia. I don't want to mute anybody. Okay. It's important that folks, if they have that sort of feedback, that they are.
So, Dr. Tony, could you do me this? Didn't mean to stop you. Can you do me this huge favor? Just yeah. Mute everybody while you're doing your presentation, and then open it up.
Man, I love that feedback though, but okay, let me.
Oh, you got feedback too.
Well, no. I like feedback.
Oh, he wants to hear people talk, Sister Barbara. But what you're not getting is that person that is making so much noise. It's very hard to hear what you're saying.
Okay, so let me go to. Okay, so how do I do that? Do I go to audio settings?
You go to participants, and you have the power to mute
everybody.
Yeah, so if you go, or if you just go to that number.
Did I do it? Okay. Because I can't hear you. Okay. All right.
Don't worry, Tony. Guess what? Because we can unmute ourselves. Because that person is not listening anyway.
Oh, good.
They just kept making noise because I just unmuted myself.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Yeah, so you get your feedback. Yeah.
Okay. I got scared there for a minute because everybody was doing it and I couldn't. Hey.
We with you.
I love you. Yeah, see? Amen. You hear us? We're with you and we don't hear that person anymore.
Amen.
We with you.
Okay, thank you. All right, so let me close this out. All right. Wait a minute. I got to go back. There we go. Okay. So what we're talking about is using the time we have here to rekindle peace. And when we look at the law of peace, peace is the chief requirement for sharing in God's oneness. Share it in God's wisdom and power. The African concept that I want us to think about and come away with, very simple word, much more difficult to do. And that word is balance. Balance. Feel me. Trying to find the balance is a lifelong learning. It's a lifelong exploration. Yes. but it's so important in terms of developing peace. And don't let anybody fool us, right? Balance is an African concept. It's a concept on which we predicate even our therapies. Dr. Patricia?
So, people that know me know that I'm a Christian too, right? Yeah. And that's weird to people, because how can you be so African and you're Christian? But anyway, in Christianity, one of the things is the fruits of the Spirit. And I always said the one I want is peace, even over joy, because it's like, I need to be satisfied and content wherever I am.
Yes.
Joy is cool, but without peace, you know, that's just all. So that's very interesting that would be the chief requirement in what you're presenting, because that is the chief requirement for me as a Christian sister.
So, what we're trying to bring people to do often when we're working with folks is to bring them towards balance. And, you know, loss knocks us out of balance in a number of ways, right? So as below, so is it above, mm-hmm. right? We're going to go from the macro to the micro and talk about balance in our own systems. Our own systems here, and that becomes important. Thank you, Dr. Patricia. Don't let anybody fool you. You know, folks have stolen all kinds of things from Africa, concepts from Africa. The cross, African. The swastika, for the four elements, African. And they've stolen these things and bastardized these things in so many ways. Swastika had nothing to do with Nazism. Mm. Not when the ancient Cometans or Egyptians mm-hmm. had it on their pyramids mm-hmm. long before Europe was even a society or a land. It was the landmass, and that's it. Yeah, so we're talking African stuff here. I wanna talk a little bit about chronic stress, because I understand that through this environment of toxicity, right? That there's a lot of stress, enough to go around, whether it's the stress of dealing with school and how you're going to deal with school, right, with your children, stress of economics, how are we going to make a dollar in order to pay bills, stress of do I have COVID-19, or I thought I might have had it, but I don't know. Mm-hmm. Should I get tested? Should I not get tested? Or the stress of watching the television and watching the body count go up on a daily basis. And then the stress of watching these knuckleheads in the Midwest do what they're doing, right? As the numbers spike. And that's just the COVID-19 stuff that we're talking about. Yeah. So I wanna make the point protecting our immune response and respecting our immune response. Here's the thing, you know, 700-800 years ago, as we were in our areas, right, and we were in the kingdom of Mali or Songhe, in any one of these areas, we're going to school in Timbuktu, so on and so forth, we were much more concerned with issues of nature, and there were always dangers. Not only did we mix with the environment, meaning the earth, as well as plants and different elements, but we also had predators that we had to deal with and had to, you know, prepare for. We had battles in between different societies that we had to prepare for. And the body developed a way of recognizing these pathogens from the earth, from the plants, from animals, so on and so forth, and building up immunity to those pathogens. Makes sense, right? Mm-hmm. It just makes sense. We also, here's the thing about the immune system. People understand the role of fight or flight or freeze, right? When the sympathetic is triggered and we've got it prepared for battle, right? But guess what? If we know that we're getting ready to go to war, right, the immune system automatically kicks in to prepare us for what may happen. We might get cut. and we'll have to heal. So there are certain aspects of the immune system that have to be engaged in order to help us heal from bacteria that might be involved or whatever the case may be, right? We haven't had the war yet. It's just in preparation, right? So what we're talking about is being engaged in fight or flight, because after we had the battle, we come home and we have something to eat and then we're at peace. After we had to deal with a hyena or something out in the elements, right? And we had to kill it because it was coming after what we had. There was a time we can go back home and we can chill, right? But what we're talking about is living in a society at this point where there is chronic stress. The fight or flight reaction never has an opportunity to pause, to go on pause. In addition to that, we know a lot more today about the gut-brain axis. We know that when the immune response is triggered in our body, that the immune response is also triggered in our brain. The brain has its own immune system. It has its own autoimmunity, right? It's centered around what's called microglia. And one triggers the other and vice versa, right? So for example, when we let's say at one time we have some sort of sickness, malaria, right? Or some sort of tuberculosis, and we're getting well. Well, what does the body do? The body, its immune system begins to prepare and to begin to fight the tuberculin bacteria and do what it needs to do in order to kill the unhealthy bacteria. We might have, you know, the shakes, we might have, a fever, our bones might hurt, all that kind of stuff. But guess what else is going on? Microglia in the brain, right, is pruning those areas of the brain, those signals in the brain that normally would allow us to be elevated in our mood, to feel up, to go out, to party, right? To engage, social engagement, right? All that kind of stuff. Well, microglia is working on those elements in our brain so we don't feel that. As a matter of fact, all we want to do is throw our heads under the covers, stay in bed, right? Stay in bed. We have a general malaise. We're feeling somewhat depressed, right? Lower mood. We just want to be in bed. Leave me alone. You know, don't even bring me any soup. Get away from me. Well, guess what? Get away from me is not only about survival, right? Because the body has to sit still and let the body do what it's doing. So the mind helps that to happen. But it also prevents the person with tuberculosis from going out and infecting the family and infecting society. So it was an evolutionary means of protecting ourselves in society. Sister Patricia, Dr. Patricia.
Okay, so go slow. Mm-hmm. Did I hear that when I'm sick and I don't feel like doing nothing, mm-hmm. my brain is making me feel that way because I don't need to be doing anything. I need to be focused on recovery.
Absolutely. And your brain does not allow you to go out and spread what you have. It keeps you socially isolated.
Okay, so, but that's not the same as if I'm sick and now I'm depressed. Is that different?
Because I think they are married.
Oh boy, that's complicated. That's complicated. Okay.
They're married. Understand, in order for you to get well, right, we gotta sit our behinds down and just chill.
And be depressed?
Well, not necessarily be depressed, but understand depression, right? Under depression, we don't feel like going out. We don't be like, we don't feel like being social beings. We're not our usual self. The brain, right, is not signaling the way that it normally would signal.
So, okay, and then I'm gonna get out the way. So now, say I'm sick, I don't wanna go party, and it's my sister Barbara's birthday party. I just really wanna be there, but I can't, you know, my brain is stopping me because I'm so depressed. So now I go take something to undepress me. and notice I just left that so open to get undepressed so I can go turn up at her party.
Right, or to make you
feel- gotta go.
Or to make you hide the fact that you're sick.
Okay, yeah.
Right? And everyone else at the party gets infected.
Wow. Wait, so you're saying the brain is a a collective thing that really want to look out for everybody?
Ubuntu is always collective.
Yeah, oh, my goodness. Wait, always, look at, okay.
All right. It always was collective, right? We're one. And the brain,
that's deep, Tony. That's deep.
There's no dichotomy. Right? Between the mind and the brain and the body. It's all one.
Wow.
So what the research is finding now is that the brain has its own immune system, right? And that immune system comes on when it needs to come on. It prunes, right? Synapses, right? And it has a really important role. But this thing we call sickness syndrome, right? Is when we have runaway microglia activity. In other words, through chronic stress, we trigger neuroinflammation. Inflammation in the body, inflammation in the brain, right? And at this point in time, it becomes very, very important for us to develop strategies for grieving.
Okay, let me stop you again because I like basic. So, inflammation, what is that for inflammation for dummies, and what, explain that and the role of that? Because I'm not really clear about that, because inflammation, it's like, that's a bad thing.
Right, inflammation can be a good thing, but there are no poisons, right? There are substances, and they can be poisonous, or they can be health promoting. That's the balance that's in the universe. So when it comes to, and so I'm gonna answer that, but then I'm gonna go through some things really quickly because I think we only got about 15 minutes, right? So here's the thing. Inflammation is very, very important. If we get a cut, we send blood, and the blood sends nutrients and other elements to the cut in order to heal it, right? While it's swollen, it's being healed. As we break a bone, that area will become swollen, right? It's immobilized, and we send all the stuff that it needs, right, in order to help to begin to heal it. And inflammation in the brain is the same thing. There are pathogens, right, that need to be dealt with in the brain. Right? And the brain does so, but it can be triggered at the wrong time. It can be over-triggered, right? We can have runaway neuroinflammation. And that's what's not good. So there are a number of inflammatory triggers, understand. And we're just talking about the regular stuff. I mean, losing somebody, right, early on in life, or kids being homeless, or having somebody, an adult in your life that's alcoholic and it's unpredictable. The person comes in, you don't really know what to expect. All these things that we go through, chasing bullets, like we used to go through in South Central. I grew up in South Central. It was always on and popping. I had my black gloves. I had to be ready every time I left the house, Those are the things that we end up going through, right? dealing with a friend that's pregnant early on, and helping them through that, dealing with all sorts of stressors. But understand that in addition to that, we've got inflammatory triggers like household cleaning products, like exhaust and the pollution that we have to deal with. We have inflammatory triggers because, and I'm going to get to this issue of social media in teenagers, but understand that the prospect of being put out, being cast out from your society, right, is a trigger. It's a stressor, and it's an inflammatory trigger, right? And understand that the role of neuroinflammation means that neurons are being pruned in very important areas, which is why stress is directly tied to the what we see in our elders who have early Alzheimer's, right? Some of them who experience Parkinsonian-like symptoms, all these things. This is not the kind of talk that we end up getting when we go to a therapist typically, but we all have to get there. We have to eventually, we got to start dealing with neurodegeneration and the kind of stress that we're under, because when we look at our people as professionals, we have to be able to look 20 years ahead when we're sitting with that person right in the here and now. It's very important. So that's the regular stuff, right? Bills and all that stuff. But what about the stuff that we as Black people have to deal with, right? The stress and the triggers related to poverty, related to racism, oppression related to racism, economic oppression related to racism, right? Violent assault or murder related to racism, whether or not it's internalized, right? I hate my brother that I'm, my beautiful brother right there that I'm looking at, and I can't stand him because he looks like me, and I can't stand myself, right? Based on racism. And that level of sickness, we have to deal with that. So I want to, and this is in the area of parenting under quarantine, because social media is no joke. And the research that's coming out on social media from those youngsters who grew up with social media, right? Those folks who are 28 years old at this point sort of missed it, right? Not that they didn't go back, they weren't aware of it, but I'm talking about growing up on social media. And this is very important, especially for girls, especially for little girls, from the middle school age to high school age, right? The research that comes out of Johns Hopkins has indicated that for young ladies, who are on the smartphone, social media, for more than 5 hours, greater than 5 hours, versus those who are on social media for less than an hour a day, have a 71% likelihood of depression. That's how stark it is. And why? Because we are, hold on just for a second, Sister Patricia, we're wired for social connectedness. We're wired to be social beings. These young ladies are wired to be, it's natural for them. It's natural for them. Texting underneath the table in class, it's all natural for them. But understand that the sort of communication that goes on in social media, right, sets up little girls to swim in a body of, in a sea of body shaming, self-hating, emotion suppressing, fear-primed, self-blaming, toxic emotional soup. And that's not my quote. I got that quote from Nakazawa from Angels and Assassins. Little boys on the other, boys face their own version of being bombarded with these messages about what it's like and what it's supposed to be like to be a man, right? And so we have to really question who's setting these standards, right? For manhood, right? I mean, you know, coming up, I wanted to knuckle up with the best of them, you know, let's go, right? But, you know, what does that mean as I become a late teenager and young adult when it comes to power, to real power, right? Understand that no one wants to be put out. And little girls can be vicious. I'm preaching to the choir, but y'all know what I'm talking about. And the understand that, remember when people were preparing for war and we knew that we were going, you know, the system gets up and going and our immune system starts to kick in automatically, right? Starts to kick in. And, you know, we haven't even had the fight yet. Well, the prospect of being shamed, the prospect of being blamed, the prospect of being talked about, right? Being put out of the little group, right? Is stress inducing and lends to chronic stress. And guess what? The immune system that used to attack these different pathogens that we knew, right? Because the system is smart, it's ready for it. You know, well, when this kind of foliage, when we pass this foliage, we get poison, this or that, right? And then, you know, we know how to attack that, right? Because the killer T cells know what's happening. The memory T cells, boom, they make a copy of it and boom, they can get at it quickly, you know, the next time it happens. Well, the immune system today is confused, which means that it begins to attack itself, which is why we end up with so many autoimmune disorders and autoimmune related diseases, right? Because we're triggered. We're in a sea of triggering and in a body that is so used to attacking certain pathogens that we don't see anymore. We don't walk on dirt anymore, we walk on concrete, right? Things are, you know, much cleaner, but we still have very serious immune systems, right? So this is, Sister Barbara, I don't know how we're gonna do this. What I wanted to introduce to you, and I'll just introduce it here, is something
Dr. Tony, just keep going, brother.
Well, our Baba Wade introduced this, right?
Okay.
Five-star family plan, an enhancement plan. This is something that, you know, we can get. It's on the website. I know it's on the Brotherhood of Elders Network website, but I want people to just go in and grab it, and I'll show you what it looks like. And what Baba Wade mentioned was that history teaches us that all these sorts of challenges to our health and safety are fueled by ignorance, lack of information, fueled by bigotry. And this sort of ignorance ignites people's anxieties and fears in the worst way. And COVID-19 is no different. This whole notion that, you know, yeah, we are susceptible, right? But, you know, Just when white folks in the Midwest found out that, well, there's a lot of people of color dying from it, they were out in droves.
Mm.
You know, they were out in droves. This notion that somehow the disease spreads impartially, right, is just ludicrous. It's ridiculous. But it's important that we find our way to peace, even in this environment, right? We incorporate in the concept of healing, the concept of salbona. And I want to, let me go here and share this with you. this. Okay. And let me share this with you. Okay. All right. Sorry, I got some stuff open that I don't even need. Okay, here we go. Share. Okay, here we go. All right, can you all see that? Yes? Okay, let me, okay, you good? You see it? Okay, good. So this is While Sheltering in Place. It's a guide and workbook. And I'm gonna ask everybody to pick this up, right? Because the concept, and Sister Barbara, you were talking about love, right? And that's the basis. That's right on, right? Zola, right? We are encouraged to Zola up on us. And the term Zola comes from the Bantu Congo, right? It means love. And so Dr. Fukia left us with a number of terms and interpretations, right? And Zola was one of them. And so this is a manual that encourages us to Zola up on us, love up on us. And it has a number of different strategies. That are designed to have us focus on these areas, really pay attention to these areas, right? Pay attention to our anger, when we're agitated, right? Get in touch with that, right? Get it, pay attention to being confused, unforgiving other people, right? Especially in our own family, you know, love up on us, right? Not only is it a good thing to do, but it also prevents us from being triggered. It prevents us, it dials down the issue of stress, right? It helps us to contend with the moment. So we're encouraged to use the time to learn more about ourselves and one another and building trust and community. And in order to do that, what he's created here is a workbook, sort of a strategy book, right? And the first one here is remember. And I'm gonna leave this and go back to my presentation. Now, are you all seeing the presentation? Or are you still on, you're seeing? Okay. So we're encouraged to Zola up on us to really look at the five-star plan.
No, right? We're just seeing, Tony, we're seeing the workbook. We're not seeing the presentation.
Oh, okay. Because I got to go in and
We're only seeing the workbook.
Okay. So I got to stop share. I got to share again.
Yeah, there's some kind of way to split share, but don't even try.
No, I ain't messing with that.
Yes, now we're on the, now we can see the PowerPoint.
So we're talking about Zola up on us, right? And the five R's: remember, remind, reframe, revitalize, and reward. Right? And so as we remember that, right, the first one, remember. And I'm not going to go through all of them, but just to give you a sense of what the book is about. Remember who we are and whose we are. We should remember that we are magnificent people birthed from the womb of Africa. We are African people in the diaspora. From Kemet to Kansas City, from Sudan to Suriname, from Ouagadougou to West Oakland, from South Africa to South Carolina, from St. Croix to St. Louis, from Mali to Mississippi, from Brixton to Brooklyn, we have been visionaries and have born visionaries and the valiant peacemakers, power brokers, scholars, and seers, scientists, business magnates, and healers. We are awesome, beyond measure, and as ancient as the origins of humanity itself. And we belong to a people deeply rooted in spirit that is expressed in our bodies, traditions of familyhood, and kinship. And then we would be encouraged to share thoughts that come up, right, as we read that statement. And I'm going quickly here, but can you all see this, global oneness? Oh, well, I forgot. I have you on. Let me see you. Can you all see this? Okay, good. So the notion of saubona, and the reason we try to use the African terms when we can is because it's so multi-layered. It's so multi-layered. So is Zola. But this is an example, and I borrowed this from the training that we put together, just so that we get a sense of saubona and what that, you know, the deepness in the way that we would greet each other, you know, knowing ourselves when we were in our original minds, right?
Saubano is one of the primal words when people were still able to really see each other. In fact, the word says, we see you. So it's not a single eye person. The eyes are connected to a dimension of reality we call ancestral, ancestors. So my seeing includes my ancestors. My seeing also includes the divinities that are part of the celestial spheres of reality. So Saubona says, we see you. And the response is, Yebo Saubona, yes, we see you.
Yebo.
Because it's a dialogue. Seeing is a dialogue. It establishes you as a witness to some phenomenon that can also be a witness to your own presence. But when two human beings meet in this gesture of Saubona, the acknowledgement is we see each other. That becomes an agreement because we're obligated from that point to affirm the reality that seeing has empowered us to investigate our mutual potentials for life. So it invites us to communicate, why are we, if we're seeing each other, why are we here at the same time? What is this moment of time giving us to be able to do? So it's an invitation to participate in each other's life. Seeing Saubona also obligates a person to give to each other what's needed for that moment of life to be enhanced. For me, now seeing represents the question, how can I be, or how do I have to be in order for you to be free? Because I think our present civilization has taken away freedoms from human beings. Not because one culture oppressed another, but because we lost the imagination of what sight meant, of what these inner capacities really mean. So for me, it's important to reestablish the question, how do I have to be as a human being for someone else to be free? You tell me, and I would explore that possibility. Because I think inwardly, we all know what the prerequisites are for our own freedom. It's a type of consent. It's a type of agreement we need in order to exercise freedom. We can't do it out of self-interest. Freedom can't be pursued out of self-interest. Freedom must be a mutual gift from one human being to another, recognizing that if I limit one person's freedom, I limit my own. That we can't take away something from someone that is so mutually tied to the state of existence. Freedom is not from something or to achieve something. It's the freedom to be present with.
Okay.
So, you know what I thought about immediately is the thievery you were talking about earlier.
Yes.
So, remember the, what is that? Oh, that movie, those people that were in that other world and they were like, I see you. And everybody thought it was so powerful. What am I talking about? Y'all know, right? You know, unmute you guys. So remember that movie where it's like they would fall asleep and live in this other world and the way they would like, I see you, you see me, you know. Anyway, the point is, it's an African concept that everybody thought was brilliant, and they weren't giving it to Africa, they were giving it to, you know, credit to something else.
Okay, we gotta find out what movie that is, though.
Well, you guys know, it's the one, remember where they, the guy that was a vet, and his legs were cut off, but in the virtual world, he would become somebody, and he ended up marrying this lady, and they would all touch each other, and that's how they would heal. They would rock, and y'all know.
Okay, we're gonna table it, but I do want to know what that movie is, Dr. Patricia.
Barbara, so, you know?
No. I don't know what it is, but you know, as you were saying, it's important for me. When I see another sister, I look at her and I said, I look at her and I nod. It's like, I see you.
Yes.
And 9 times out of 10, majority of them don't look back at me and say, I see you. But I still walk away with knowing that I hopefully, prayerfully gave her a gift. And it's crazy because it would be another nationality walking with her.
Right.
And we're both, the other one there, we're the same, but the other one would see me and this sister won't see me.
Yeah.
And it's crazy because that's just what we all was just talking about, how society has brainwashed us out of seeing each other.
Yeah.
It's crazy, but.
It is. But you know, it's about getting back to ourselves, right?
Yeah, we do.
And part
that's what this is about, yes.
And part of getting back to ourselves is developing ritual because spirit is not as contained as we think it is, that we've been led to believe, right? You know, lighting a candle, you know, we're talking about grieving, lighting the candle, actively speaking to the spirit of that person and being open, right? To that person speaking back, that spirit is important. Dr. Patricia.
The movie is Avatar.
Oh, yeah.
Avatar. And what's sad about the movie, if you think about it, is they're trying to tell you that that's not real, that you really can't have that world. But it was the African world. Remember in Avatar how they rock and heal and give? Yeah. I had to go ask my daughter. Sorry. Yeah,
thank you very much. But absolutely, all African concepts.
As you were saying, Dr. Patricia, right there, it's about the spirit. That goes back, and as Dr. Tony alluded earlier, it's the spirit in us. Society has allowed us to not tune in to our spirit, and it's taken away from our spirit. And we were talking, the peace brings the spirit back in, because then you are centered, balanced back with yourself and with the universe, with people, and our ancestors. So like the brother was just speaking, it becomes a multi-layered of things once you do that and you experience. And the reason why people are losing it now, because the spirit has not been fed like it was supposed to be fed. And society has stripped, of course, away from us being spirit-led versus have to be on all the time. On all the time, gotta go, gotta move, you can't be still, and you can't even be still with your own thoughts. Some people don't even want to be okay with their thoughts. You know, when I was growing, well, when I had my kids, and I'm gonna stop with this. I would have a mental shutdown, quiet time with them. And what I would have them do once they got from school and we got home, they had to do this for 1 hour. So I told them, you've been talking since the time you got up in the morning to the time you done got home. So now what I want you to do, all of us gonna do this, and it's a mental shutdown quiet. You can read a book, you can draw, you can do whatever you want, but you're going to be quiet and silent. So to me, it gave them the opportunity to tune in and be okay with themselves. Mm-hmm. And other folks, it's like, before they were like, they thought I was being mean, but now they were like, oh, Miss B, I did that mental shutdown quiet time. I'm like, uh-huh. But it's just to get the people back in tune with themselves, to be okay with you, and to listen, to be able to listen to yourself, be able to listen to the spirit. So I'm gonna stop right there. I got more to say,
This is a great discussion. It really is. Can you all see this? Where I'm scrolling up? Wait a minute. I'm sorry. I keep asking you, but then okay, good.
Yes.
So I just want to support what you're just saying, Sister Barbara, and that is the need to just be quiet sometimes, to just listen to the universe, and allow ourselves to be African, because it's not only going to save our lives, but it's also going to save humanity. And it makes sense that it's going to save humanity, because that's where humanity started. Mm. All these concepts, if you just look through them, we're talking about African concepts and bringing these concepts into our home and into our lives, right? And just being mindful of them when they're there. Also, you know, to grow from that. And this page is called African Cultural Wisdom. Now, you know, we've been taught that it comes from a lot of other places, you know, from back east and, you know, any number of people, anywhere but from Africans. But that in fact is not the case. We're talking about African concepts. And these are going to be brief notes, because I really appreciate you all's patience, too, and being live and with us during this presentation.
You know, Dr. Tony, we can sit and watch foolishness and be all, and getting some nourishment to feed our spirit and soul. I'm with this, but I get you. I'm respecting everybody. And yes, but we, it's like your body yearns for knowledge and for something to heal and to promote healing for ourselves and others. So this is like dealing with all of that. And it's like, okay, thank you for some balance.
What's AMAP? Communicate with others. AMAP, what's that?
As much as possible. Much as possible.
Thank you. I'm glad to go ask my daughter. What's that? Okay.
And these are probably things that we're doing anyway.
I'm like, what's digital detox? Guess what I meant? I was thinking digits, your fingers, right? And I'm like, oh, media, TV.
Yes. Detox.
Turn
it off.
You know, I actually, you know, it's sad, but I laugh at Trump, you know, when I see him on. So it's, you know, for me, I'm looking at what this idiot is doing, you know, when I'm watching news on a daily basis. Problem is that, you know, with my wife and daughter, they don't necessarily laugh the same way that I'm laughing at. So I've got to be conscious of, you know, turning that stuff off sometimes, you know, just because I can watch it. But, you know, getting away from it, sometimes getting away from the onslaught of information around COVID is a good thing to do, and just to breathe, you know, practice good mental hygiene, and of course, eat as best as we can. Eat as well as we can. Very, very important. What I've added here are just a few things to think about for maximum stress support. Eating for stress support. And that is to have bioflavonoids, botanicals, and antioxidants in your diet. And the way nature planned this thing, sometimes, you know, having the range of colors in terms of the foods that we eat can provide us with a wealth of antioxidants. Very, very important.
Somebody, Tony, I think Baba Wakasey, he taught us this. He said, A, B, C, D, Z for zinc.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the ones you need.
And I would say
A, B, C, D, Z for zinc. Wait, A, B, C, D, E, and Z for zinc. I forgot E. Yeah.
You forgot E.
Yeah, he said E. So it's A, B, C, D, E, and Z for zinc.
I would highlight D, because what I...
That's what I was doing, give me some sun.
That's it. Yep. Because Black folk need it.
Yeah.
Sun people. So listen, we have... What's that?
I said, let me tell you about it, because when I sit and let the sun beam on me, I feel refreshed. I feel like I'm in one. I feel like...
Me too, Bob. Yeah.
I feel everything that I need to move. Mm-hmm. That sun just gives me everything that I personally need for myself.
Yes.
So I love acting in the sun. Yes, you're so right.
And guess what we have not been getting? Right? So not only every brother and sister that I see in practice, usually, you know, in most cases, you know, it's a rarity that you know, I'm not looking at it, but I'm asking them for their blood work, or I'm asking them to make sure they include D levels in their blood work, because I want to see where they are. Most of us are chronically deficient in D, because we need more sun than other people do. That's fact. And vitamin.
So, Tony, you know what you could tell them to do? Like, this is what I do. Like, mm-hmm. I sit at my patio window. Yes. When the sun is shining on me, so if they don't want to go outside, they could just get by somewhere that the sun is shining in intensely.
On a day like today, great, especially in Oakland, right? But in the Bay Area tends to have a fog, right?
True.
And the Bay Area still ain't Africa, and there's something in our genes that keeps calling for African sun. You know, So I look at the blood work for everybody, and I look at their D levels. We're talking about 60 different biochemical reactions that D are involved in the brain. And we feel so much better with proper vitamin D levels. So definitely I have people take vitamin D, D3. You know, don't bother with D2. Because that's the cheap stuff that unfortunately, you know, and one of these physicians had the nerve to, you know, prescribe D2 for my mother, right? And I'm like, I was so mad. Garbage, right? And then I had her taking some ungodly dose. Well, you got to with D2 because it's inferior. So D3, it's relatively inexpensive. You know, take it. It's just good for us. And then for sure get sun. When it comes to teas, you know, anything with echinacea in it is good. It's good to use on an ongoing basis. It helps build immunity. Acai, blueberry, and raspberry, very, very strong antioxidants. You know, really nice to use. And you know, this... Any viral infections impact our immune system. So it's important to just build a strong immune system. And something that I am working on myself, doing a lot of different things, but I need to get more sleep.
I'm doing that too. I try to be in the bed before midnight now, and I never used to do that. So I shoot for 11, and by midnight, I got to be in the bed. Yeah.
It's hard. I've been doing like 1:45 in the morning, not good. Then I dialed it back to 1, trying to dial it to 12. Then I'm gonna try to dial it to 11. Not good. Sleep. You guys get sleep. It's the most important thing that you can do in terms of the immune system. Sleep. You got it, Brother Wayne. The most important thing that you can do in terms of weight loss. Sleep. Sleep.
Tony, can you explain, the guy, this Bobby with Casey again, says something about you need to be in bed by 11 because something about the melanin, something, that's the hour between 11 and 12. What is it talking about? You know what I'm talking about, right?
Look at it this way. All the stuff that brings us to other worlds, to tap into our subconscious, all those things can tend to kick in when we're asleep or when we're rest, when our brains are experiencing certain frequencies, right? Going to theta and delta frequencies. And so yes, I advocate that. And the more, right, the merrier. That's why we have circadian rhythms, right? Very few people, there are some people who are biologically, they have a predisposition to have an altered clock, right? But most of us end up altering our clocks by coffee, you know, caffeine too late, and you know, other sorts of activities that will impact our hippocampus, right? So, you know, there's a night and there's a day for a reason for us, right? I mean, we get into it. Our breathing is even, you know, by the 12 hours clock. We breathe stronger, right? During in one nostril for 12 hours than we do the other, right? So the law of opposites are alive and well in us, right? Including hemispheres of the brain, including the type of breathing we do that we can do for digestion, as well as for stress release. For pranayama, for example, and then I'll close this out. You know, when we feel ourselves becoming stressed, we can practice pranayama. Some people do this, right? And then I like to do just this, where you take a breath in to your left nostril.
Tony, you need to take that off and put just you so I can see what you're doing. Oh, you know, make just you in the screen because I don't have my glasses on and stuff. Oh. So what are you doing? What you did? Or else get closer to the camera so I can see what you, when you talk about prana something.
Okay.
Okay, that's better. Yeah, all right.
Okay.
All right. So
what I'm doing is I'm going over the right nostril, breathing in.
You know I'm like a child.
Through the left deeply. Then with the index finger, I'm plugging the left and then breathing out.
Wait, do that again. Wait. Okay, so.
Breathing in to the right. And then alternating. And breathing out to the left. Breathing in to the left. Hold the left, breathing out in the right. Just like that. So
and what's that called?
It's pranayama.
Pranayama.
Yeah. And the thing about it is it will almost instantly relieve stress or put us in a calmer state when we need it. Any sort of situation, right? So I'll close this by saying sleep, by all means, release opioids, do exercise, laugh as much as possible.
Laugh at Trump.
You got, who's my man? Dave Chappelle, right? You know, Dave Chappelle, any of those comedians, right? Mm-hmm. Go on, laugh. The release of opioids is very, very important. Get high sugar diets, you know, really, really pay attention to those diets. You know, try to mediate your sugar early in the day so you're not eating it later in the day. And these are things, these are things that, when I talk about balance and just ongoing trying to build the discipline, you know, I try to do the same things.
You said if you gotta have the sugar, eat it earlier as opposed to later?
Try to eat it early in the day, yeah.
But eliminate it is the best thing.
Elimination, but not to the point where you're going to simply crave and that's all you think about. So
Then you're gonna go crazy when you do.
Yeah, gotcha. There are ways to do it. You know? But definitely understand that sugar shuts down our immune system. Right. So if we're talking about COVID-19,
what kind of substitutions
viral infections. Well, you know, high sugar diets cut down, they impact natural T killer cells, you know, and they can cut it down. They can cut them down for hours.
Wow.
Yeah. Dehydration also is a monster. So we got to make sure that we, you know, we're getting our water, right? There's a whole field called psychoneuroimmunology that looks at our state of mind and the impact on our immune system. Okay. And so I'm gonna close by thanking you for your attention and time. And hopefully we covered something that you know, hit. I know I've enjoyed the comments and the questions.
Wait, Tony, before you stop, one thing that I've been telling people, and so tell me, because you're better at this than me, right? Okay, so since COVID is like a lung disease, you gotta strengthen your lungs, right? So I've been telling people, y'all gotta eat that stuff and not smoke it, because this is not the time. So, because it's like that might relax you, but that ain't gonna be good for the, so am I telling them right in that?
Absolutely. you know, edibles, you know, or the cannabinoid oil, right?
After smoking, this ain't the time to be smoking, right?
Not the time to smoke. I think what smoking does with the cilia, you know, in your lungs, is always sort of problematic. You know, I think it's problematic. But there are a number of creative ways. If you are doing marijuana, there are a number of creative ways to do it. That where you don't have to smoke. You know, they're actually making some pretty decent brownies nowadays. They're making, you know, all that kind of stuff. I will, you know, for some of my clients, I will prescribe for them, suggest CBD oil, but it depends. It really depends on what they're grappling with, but not only their state of mind, whether or not there's some sort of psychiatric issue, right? So you gotta keep all of that in
balance, balance.
The balance.
Dr. Tony's word, you gotta balance it.
In Africa. That's so, it.
If you're done, Dr. Tony, first of all, BH Bring Your Minds Project Inc. wants to thank you for being the first person to do the Tap In series. We yes, just want to say thank you. We appreciate you. And I am also going to leave us with this. It says, we are holding on to the principles of Amani, faith, by expressing our thoughts in an authentic way, using essential healing practices while facing the impact and challenges of COVID-19. We recognize the importance of us coming back strong. So what this series is going to do is promote, encourage, motivate us to come back stronger than ever before, but on a whole new level. We're trying to teach people, take away the as we would say, the abnormal becomes normal, but we want the normal to be normal. We wanted us to get back to what we normally supposed to do and how we're supposed to think and how we're supposed to feel. And I do definitely want to thank the Akinati Foundation, their So Love Can Win Foundation, Grant is what's sponsored this series. And I just want to say, Dr. Patricia, Wayne, to Jackie Howard, Melody Howard, Samantha, to all and the ones that have tuned in, we thank you. We appreciate you. Please, this has been recorded, hopefully prayerfully, that we can pass it on and we'll continue this conversation. And we're going to do this together. That's what family is all about. And I
Sister
see.
Barbara, so it's okay to share? It's okay to share the recording? Okay.
Yeah. You'll be able to edit it. There's a way that there's an edit function too that you can use and cut out all the stuff at the beginning, you know, too.
Right on.
Yeah, thank you for having me, Sister B, and thank, you know, y'all live. This is a live crew. I mean, you know, everybody's feedback and everything else, man. And I hope, you know, when I went into grad school, I had the goal of just wanting to be able to still do the running man when I got out. I didn't want to leave my ghetto past. I didn't want to forget how to
never forget where we come from.
So,
That's right. And you know, we're also going to have Dr. Patricia Nunley on the series of Tapping Into.
So yay!
AB Sci is the book. So,
okay. I think it's something good we're going to talk about.
All right. Appreciate you.
And Mr. Wayne will be on it as a series too. So we
solid. All right.
Hey, Mr. Wayne.
I really appreciate it this time, man. It was so connecting. Something I've been talking to a lot of people about. I did a training in Chicago, and it talked about trauma and healing, and a lot of it talked about the nervous system and connected to a lot of the stuff that Dr. Tony talked about today, the autonomic nervous system, the central nervous system, how the gut and the brain is connected. But one of the main topics that kept coming up is our connectedness, how we're disconnected. And our healing is supposed to happen amongst the village. And we don't have that. And they showed this video that was so mind blowing of an animal getting caught by a lion. And a hyena came along and the lion ran off. The animal was acting like it was dead because it was like in that fight, flight, or freeze mode.
Mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm.
And when the lion ran off, the animal shook. His nervous system
shake the trauma off.
And then went back to the, and it makes me think, and they talked about how we don't get to go back to a healthy community. Yeah. And so when we're trying to come out of freeze mode,
right,
we never come out of freeze or fight or flight because we don't get the process through. And I love what Dr. Tony was talking about.
Uh-oh, you froze. A lot of our community
don't recognize that we are spiritual beings having a earthly experience.
That's right.
That by itself right there, once that kicked in with me about 5 years ago, it changed my whole life. You know, I realized like, I'm not, and then I even talk a lot to my young people when I'm doing workshops with them and talking about how we're human beings, not human doings.
Right.
We're supposed to be being, we're supposed to be existing, being. But yet we're living this unbalanced life where we're doing, do. I mean, even in places I go and I meet people, they walk up, I've started doing this in the last 2 years. And hey, what do you do? And I tell them, how about I tell you who I am? And it messes people up all the time because it's not about what I do. It's about who I'm being, you know? And so I get to tell them I'm a father, I'm a black man, you know, and it just messing people up, you know? So this was so aligned and it felt good for me right now. It felt like I was home. That's another statement y'all said that I'm always saying, man, life is, one of my mentors told me, life is always about coming home to yourself. It's a whole journey of just coming home to yourself because we've been ripped away from who we originally were. That's so right. It's a whole journey about, so this is like, everything I was hearing was just like, oh, this is confirmed.
Wayne, who, because I want to cite that, coming home to, a journey of coming home to yourself. You know who said that?
One of my mentors told me, I don't know who said it originally, but I hear it in all kind of different contexts.
Wow.
But he said, because we've been pulled away from who we originally supposed to be, the whole journey of the black culture is coming home to us.
Okay, I have to just say anonymous then, but I love that.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm thankful. I'm thankful anytime I'm in the presence of Dr. Tony.
Brother, please.
And what I love about this, y'all, is I've been saying I need to connect with this group more and more and more. I kept saying, Miss B, that's my lady. I stopped by her office. I come to the West Oakland Youth Center because LaRon and all of them are my family. But I think they'd be a little jealous because once I start talking to Miss B, I don't leave her office. For hours, we be there talking for an hour. They be like, "Oh, he's still over there." I'm like, hey, "That spirit be moving." So, you know, but I've been saying I was gonna join y'all in some spaces because I really want to bring these conversations to more spaces that don't have these conversations, especially black men.
Yes.
And so I feel like this is the time. This is when I was supposed to be here, and here we are.
Yes.
It was a pleasure to have you, brother.
Yes. Definitely. Got to find a way.